50 states. Man, oh man, are they different. You know, Californians are crazy. So how do we work together? So that we can't enter into treaties. That's basically an international thing. So we can't go, hey, California, let's like gang up on New Mexico. No, that's not how it works, because that's more like a confederation and too much authority with local governments. The Constitution doesn't allow that. But we can do what's called an interstate compact. So we're going to do an agreement that basically we can make with these states. We could say, hey, when we say foreign states, I mean like a state outside the boundaries. California, we want to share the water of the Hoover Dam and the Colorado River. Okay, well then basically they write up the agreement, they show what they want to do, what it means, they send it off to Congress, Congress signs off on it, and then it's good. So they want to make sure that no state's trying to increase their power. But once Congress approves it, which we do have an interstate compact with California over the Colorado River and the Hoover Dam, and it's been, you know, in place for quite some time. So New York and New Jersey basically have an interstate compact also that looks at their port authority, because they're so close together and do share that area of the Hudson and the entrance from the Atlantic Ocean. And then, of course, the conservation of resource of water, which is the compact that California and Arizona, and I believe also Utah, has kind of entered in Nevada. So we all have that thing. Full faith and credit is a clause, basically, that means that states have to accept other public acts. So it's supposed to be that if you have a ruling in one state, the other state's supposed to accept it. You have a driver's license in one state and you go traveling in California. If you're a resident of Arizona, but you're staying in California, your Arizona driver's license is valid. However, if you try to achieve residency of California, then you have to go and get a California driver's license. If you go for, it's basically for visitors traveling through, but in terms of achieving residency, state laws that of your current residency always supersede state laws of your past residency. So civil is a marriage. Some criminal matters don't go. And of course, you cannot be granted a divorce in another state in which you do not reside. So California doesn't have, pretty much allows you to have certain divorces more quickly than states like Utah that requires a year of separation and things like that. But you can't try to divorce in another state unless one person has residency. Extradition is a big one. The legal process of retrieving a fugitive from one state to another for justice. Governors are the big ones. They're the ones that have to approve it. So this is a big thing that comes into play with capital punishment. If you want to extradite a criminal from one state that does not have capital punishment, which is the death penalty, because and then another state does have the death penalty, and this has come up where states that don't have it are like, no, we want to try him here because, you know, then he's not going to get the death penalty. Well, if the crime was committed in another state, that state does have the authority to request to the governor. But you know what? That governor can still deny. In those cases, usually when there's a strong political racial overtones, the Supreme Court is going to step in, and the federal government can do it when there's disagreements. But if it has to reach a certain point, so that governor does got a lot of power. So extradition can become a difficult thing, but you have to basically prove that there is a reason why that criminal should be tried in that state over the other. Privileges and immunities clause basically stipulates that citizens are entitled to certain privileges and immunities over in regards to state residents. So that means that no state can draw unreasonable distinctions between its own residents. So you can't basically say, well, you don't get protected because you're not official resident of the state. If they seek residency, we have to allow them to. We can't be like, oh, well, here's the way that you get residency. Oh, you can't be a resident. Oh, but you can't do that. But you can't. Okay, well, you can't. States cannot do anything that is placing in-state residents over other states. So states can't require you to if your company is in Arizona, you can't say, well, you have to hire Arizonans. Now I can hire anybody I want in the entire world because it is immunities and privileges. So there's a lot of things that are trying to basically protect people from states basically trying to take power over another state, trying to subject another state, trying to bully another state, and trying to make all of the states work together in unity and in consistency. And under the Articles of Confederation, when they were making their own independent laws and restrictions, this is what happened. You could go from one state to another and find a lot of difficulties in the different laws, and you could be treated differently anywhere you went. And that is what these laws are trying to prevent. If you are in one state, you are a citizen of the United States, regardless of what another state decides to do. So just as a quick thing in terms of looking at federalism and how it's grown, the biggest thing is how the division of powers have kind of gone. And most importantly, kind of the level, and most importantly, the cooperation. So the biggest thing is like money. A grants and aid is when the federal government is going to send states monies so that they can do certain things. And whether that be money that's free or money that is loaned to the states, the federal government helps them to pay for certain things. It also allows for revenue sharing, which is when states are going to take a portion of the federal tax revenues to their state and local governments, even though we have state and local tax revenues, to help pay for certain things that might be important, like education, federal infrastructure, and security, those kind of things. So these usually happens in a financial, but the federal government can use these financial empowerments and assistance to kind of create power over the states. Well, if you want this money, you got to do this. So pretty important. There's also different kind of grants. So you have categorical grants, which are looking at construction of airports and water treatment plants. There's usually strings attached to those, especially school lunch programs. You have block grants, which is specific money. So you have a healthcare block grant, so it has to be used towards healthcare, but doesn't dictate certain things, and usually has fewer strings attached. Project grants are for specific things like medical research, job training, employment programs. And so there's ways that the federal government is going to say, okay, well, this money goes towards education, but for this to have to do, like for school lunch programs, okay, for you to get federal money for school lunch programs, you had to serve with a certain nutritional value under certain, some federal restrictions that were passed a few years ago. If you want money for these treatment plants, you have to have a certain level of water conservation and showing environmental awareness. So the federal government does have responsibility, obligations to the states in a way that they are helping them, assisting them, and making sure that our country is strong as a whole, not just in pieces. So federalism works to unify the states and to create a hierarchy. But I hope that that was informational. I hope you were able to learn a little bit more about how the states interact with each other and the federal government. And that's about it.